Hello. In the previous talk, we saw a demonstration of ILS spoofing and ADS-B TCAS spoofing. In this talk, I'll be going over the fundamental principles and security issues of these systems. The ILS work was done in collaboration with Domain Shepherds and my advisors, Professor Anjan Ranganathan and Professor Guevara Nobir from Northeastern University. Well, yes, the ILS part is very similar to what the bad guys did in Die Hard 2. Actually, that was one of the motivation factors behind this research. Sometimes fiction does turn into reality. In recent years, aviation industry has seen a significant rise with approximately 15,000 flights in the sky at any given time. Of course, with the onset of COVID-19, this has drastically changed, but nevertheless. Atlanta's Hartsfield International Airport is considered to be the busiest airport. It itself caters to over 2,500 takeoffs and landings every single day. Right from taxiing to the runway for takeoff to arriving and taxiing back to destination gate, these flights rely on a plethora of wireless navigation aids. Pilots continuously interact with ATC using RF channels. Controllers use surveillance radar for aircraft localization. Automatic dependent surveillance broadcast enables aircraft tracking. Traffic and collision avoidance systems like ACAS and TCAS also relies on these ADS-B packets. Flights use satellite systems for general point-to-point navigation. At the end, instrument landing system gets you safely back on ground even in extreme weather conditions. In recent years, systems like ADS-B and navigation aids like GPS has been found to be vulnerable by the researchers. It is possible to include ghost aircrafts by spoofing ADS-B packets. In the previous talk, we witnessed the effects of spoofing ADS-B packets to disrupt collision avoidance systems. It has been shown multiple times how GPS is vulnerable to spoofing attacks. With the advent of real inexpensive software-defined radio platforms, it has become much easier to fabricate such disturbances. Let's take a look at instrument landing system in detail. Final approach or landing phase is one of the most critical phases. According to a Boeing report, about 59% of all fatal accidents have occurred during the final approach phase. ILS is the de facto landing system used all over the world. It provides precise guidance even in extreme weather conditions. It has three subsystems. First is a localizer. It's a component which provides lateral guidance. Glide slope provides vertical guidance, and marker beacons act as checkpoints during the approach. Let's look at the localizer in detail. Localizer enables the receiver to calculate its location with respect to the runway centerline. The instrument guides the pilot to properly align itself. Antenna array installed at the end of the runway transmits a 25-watt signal. Transmission pattern creates a lobe on each side of the runway. 90-hertz tone dominates the region on the left side of the runway, and 150-hertz tone dominates the region on the right side of the runway. The receiver is configured to interpret the power levels of the tones and guide the pilot. For example, if the aircraft is on the left side of the runway, the needle will point right, indicating that the pilot has to fly right to intercept the center line. The glide slope helps the pilot to align the aircraft with the prescribed glide path. Usually, it is a 3-degree path, but it depends on the environment. An antenna array located near the touchdown zone transmits an 8-watt signal. The transmitter is similar to that of the localizer. However, it results in a slightly different pattern. 90-hertz tone dominates the region above the glide path angle, and 150-hertz tone dominates the region below the glide path. The receiver is configured to interpret the power levels of the tones and guides the pilot. For example, if the aircraft is above the glide path, the needle will point down, indicating that the pilot has to fly down to intercept the glide path angle. In ILS, the localizer uses a VHF carrier and the glide slope uses a UHF carrier. There are two main components of the ILS signal, a 90-hertz tone and a 150-hertz tone. The unique transmission pattern is a result of elegant analog radio engineering. This unique pattern results in two zones on either side of the runway. This is achieved by implementing space modulation technique. In this technique, the characteristics of a received signal are determined by how two signals add up in space. Thus, they change with respect to receiver's position. As a direct result, 90-hertz tone dominates the region on the left, and 150-hertz tone dominates the region on the right, amplitude of these tones is equal on the runway center line. The signal modulator uses two distinct signals called carrier sideband signal CSB and sideband only signal SBO. For generating the CSB signal, 90 Hz tone and 150 Hz tones are added. And for generating the SBO tones, these are added in a slightly different way. Here, 150 Hz tone is inverted. That is, it undergoes a 180 degree phase shift. These waveforms are passed on to a modulator which generates the final CSB and SBO waveforms. This is the design of the signal modulator which is responsible for ILS's unique transmission pattern. A CSB modulating tone is modulated with a VHF carrier. To get the desired amplitude modulation form, the carrier is added back to the modulated signal. This results in a conventional amplitude modulated signal with a full carrier and sidebands. Similarly, SBO modulating tone is modulated. Note that the carrier is not added back to the modulated signal. This results in a double sideband suppressed carrier signal. Before feeding these signals to the antenna elements, the SBO signal undergoes specific phase shifts. This is done in order to achieve the desired space modulation. Alternatively, there is a provision of adding Morse code or voice to the CSB signal. It contains a four-character runway identifier, which can be used by the pilots to identify and verify the runway. As compared to the transmitter, the receiver has a rather simple design. At the receiver, the signal undergoes amplification before it is demodulated. The demodulated signal is passed to a 90 Hz filter and a 150 Hz filter. The difference in DC voltage of 90 Hz and 150 Hz tone is the difference in depth of modulation. This TDM value is used to calculate or the deflection of the instrument's needle. Radio engineering involved in the pure analog instrument landing system is quite remarkable. However, simplistic nature of the system also makes it very vulnerable to attacks. Before software-defined radios came into picture, executing these attacks was extremely difficult, not to mention expensive. Thus, only state actors had the means to carry out such an attack. However, nowadays, even you and I can execute such attacks and can potentially cause quite some damage with the cheap pocket-sized radios. A deeper analysis of the receiver design reveals that the needle deflection is solely based on the power levels of the received tones. In the past, there have been instances of ILS showing weird deflections as a result of an aircraft taxiing near the localizer antenna. Thus, an attacker simply has to transmit a signal which is similar to the real signal. That is, the attacker need not implement complex phase shifts. This is very similar to a not so widely used landing system called TLS or transponder landing system, where the landing system relies on modest transmissions to find the aircraft's position and transmits an ILS-like signal specifically crafted for that aircraft at that particular location. In these attacks, attacker's goal is to force the aircraft to overshoot the runway or completely miss the approach. Given the simplistic nature of the systems, the attacker can manipulate DDM calculations by simply altering the power levels of the received signals. In our work last year, we discussed two attacks. First is the overshadow attack, which involves signals with fabricated power levels, and singleton attack, which involves low power signals to achieve the objectives. With minor changes, the attacks work for the localizer as well as the glide slope. ILS implements basic principles of space modulation, that is how do signals add up in space. Being a simplex broadcast system, it possesses a fundamental challenge to implement any type of security mechanism, thus making attacks on these systems quite trivial. In overshadow attack, the attacker transmits a high power pre-crafted ILS signal equivalent to what will be received at a specific location. One important aspect characteristic of a typical wireless receiver is that it will always lock on to the stronger signal. This property is exploited in this attack. Since the receiver has a very simple design, the attacker has to transmit a signal similar to the received signal, even though the legitimate transmitter has quite a complex design. Hence, attacker needs to only craft the signals with specific amplitude. For example, in this case, this signal represents of the signal that will be received at the runway center line. Hence, if the attacker wants to cause a deflection, the attacker simply transmits a signal with altered power levels of 90 Hz and 150 Hz. In this case, 90 Hz is dominant. Thus, the needle will give a fly right indication. The advantage of this attack is that the attacker has granular control over needle deflections. Even though the overshadow attack requires just a few watts of transmission power, we wanted to find if the attack can be made more efficient and stealthy by reducing the energy footprint. For this, we came up with the singleton attack. Since the needle deflections depend directly on power levels of the tones, it is enough to transmit just one of the two tones that make up the ILS signal. In this way, the attacker can manipulate the power levels without having to transmit the entire ILS signal. The attacker signal is similar to a double sideband suppressed carrier signal, which is very well known to be spectrally efficient. In this case, the attacker just transmits the 150 Hz tone. As a result, the amplitude of 150 Hz is greater than that of 90 Hz tone. Thus, the instrument shows a fly left indication. This attack, as compared to an overshadow attack, has low power requirements. However, this attack is sensitive to phase difference between attacker tone and legitimate tone, which makes it quite complicated. The two attacks may seem quite simple and straightforward. However, there are certain challenges associated with executing these attacks. The first is that the aircraft can intercept the localizer from multiple directions. If the attacker is not careful while starting the spoofer, it may result in sudden needle jumps. This results in detection. The second challenge is with a naive overshadow attack. If the attacker simply starts transmitting a pre-crafted signal, it results in a fixed unreactive offset. This will make it super easy for the pilot to notice something is off and will totally forego ILS or may use some other system to land. To overcome these challenges, we developed two mechanisms: offset correction algorithm and spoofing zone detector. Let's look at them one by one. The offset correction algorithm provides signal corrections in real time. The attacker's signal is adjusted as a function of aircraft's current GPS location. This provides seamless takeover of the onboard instrument. The algorithm calculates the difference between the angle with the legitimate path and the spoof path. This offset is then used to calculate the required amplitude levels of the tones. The spoofing zone detector is responsible for timely and automated triggering of the attack. The aircraft can be vectored in on the final approach in multiple ways. Hence, to prevent any sudden needle jumps, we developed this spoofing zone detector, which uses even-odd algorithm to check if the target aircraft has entered the spoofing region. The zone covers 17.5 degrees on either side of the center line and extends 35 kilometers beyond the touchdown zone. The attacker starts transmitting as soon as the aircraft enters this region. All right, now let's take a look at ADSB. Automatic Dependent Surveillance Broadcast is a reporting technology where an aircraft repeatedly transmits position, velocity, and aircraft identification information. These packets can be received and decoded by MODIS receivers. ADS-B is similar to MODIS, except it doesn't require specific interrogation messages. As of January 2020, ADS-B transponders are made mandatory for aircrafts operating under certain conditions in US airspace. ADS-B greatly improves safety and efficiency by providing better situational awareness. It is also spectrally efficient and costs much less than MODIS setups. Collision avoidance systems like ACAS and TCAS leverage ADS-B packets. These are the signal characteristics. ADS-B uses a carrier frequency of 1090 MHz. The bandwidth is 50 kHz and it uses a simple pulse position modulation technique. Data rate for ADS-B data is 1 megabits per second and 2 packets are transmitted for every second. Polarization of the transmission antenna is vertical and transmission has a transmission power of about 20 watts. Well, all this is good about ADS-B. It improves overall safety by increasing situational awareness, decreases load on the controllers by automated tracking of aircrafts, overall decreases operational costs and all. But what about security? Well, nothing. There's absolutely none. The only thing close to security it has is a checksum. There is no way to know whether a packet is really from the aircraft that it says it is from. Moreover, everything is in clear text, which means any person with $30 to spare can effectively set up a so-called air traffic monitoring center in their homes. This has led to a lot of serious privacy concerns and equal number of oops moments. For example, when the Air Force One was spotted on one of the flight tracking websites. But that's not it. The security community has taken one step ahead and has actually managed to put ghost planes in the sky, which is quite concerning. Think of a scenario where on a busy day, ATC screen is flooded with thousands of aircrafts. What's even more concerning is the fact that the same insecure system is used in critical avoidance systems. For example, a demonstration of this was witnessed in the previous talk. These are some notable prior works which have addressed security and privacy issues associated with ADS-B. The research community is now actively looking into security and critical next generation navigation technologies. OpenSky Network, founded by Stomier et al., is a crowdsourced network of ADS-B sensors located all over the world. This is a key resource in air traffic research. Following issues have been identified by the security research community. ADS-B lacks any kind of authentication. It lacks integrity checks against intentional tampering of messages. Sure, CRC checks can correct errors, but what if the messages, including the CRC checksums, are carefully manipulated over the air? It lacks encryption and temporal identities, as it raises a major privacy concern and is a haven for eavesdroppers. And finally, it lacks a secure handshake protocol for verification, authentication, and validation of data. So with all these issues, what are the threats that current aviation ecosystem faces? Well, all these issues give rise to a number of threats, which includes jamming and denial of service attacks. As discussed earlier, flooding the radar screens with thousands of aircrafts. Well, intelligence gathering. There have been researchers or there have been incidences where people have inferred or predicted business dealings by simply monitoring flight data, which was again made available through services like Flight Data 24 and OpenSky Network. Well, there's also threat of message injection and manipulation, disruption of situational awareness, which is very specific to ACAS and TCAS spoofing, demonstration of which we saw in the previous talk. And trust me, you really do not want a pissed off air traffic controller when you fly next. Let's look at the ADS-B transmitter. ADS-B transmits position, velocity, and aircraft identification information. The preamble is used for synchronizing the receiver and for indicating that an ADS-B packet is arriving. The downlink format field is an indication of the type of message that is being transmitted. Capability field defines the subtype of the message being transmitted. Next are 24 bits, which are for aircraft's ICAO address. This is followed by actual ADS-B data, which includes altitude, latitude, and longitude. At the end, 24 parity bits are transmitted, which helps the receiver to detect errors. Raw message bits of the prepared frame undergo Manchester encoding. This is a line encoding scheme, which is very similar to binary phase shift keying. The encoded data is then modulated using pulse position modulation technique before being transmitted using the radio frequency front end at 1090 MHz. ADS-B follows a very basic insecure protocol. The encoding and modulation scheme that is used is easy to implement. Actually, there are straightforward functions in MATLAB that can perform the encoding and modulation, thus making it quite trivial to build a transmitter with a couple of $100 worth of equipment. Even better, there are open source tools out there which can do the heavy lifting for you. Lack of security measures and simple design makes the system vulnerable to spoofing attacks, especially with cheap over-the-shelf equipment like low-cost software-defined radios, amplifiers, and antennas makes it rather easy to generate and transmit malicious ADS-B packets. Well, once you have a transmitter design ready and understood, you can simply code everything and boom, a transmitter is now a fully functional ADS-B spoofer. This is a small spoofing example. Imagine being a controller and seeing this on your display. That would really piss you off. Now that we have seen the security issues associated with ILS and ADS-B, Let's go over some potential countermeasures. Recently, GPS-based landing systems are being introduced. They are not yet cleared for Cat 2 and Cat 3 approaches. However, they will be replacing good old ILS sometime in future. But we all know how vulnerable GPS is. Signal strength monitoring can be implemented for detecting overshadow attacks. Most of the ILS attacks can be executed from within the aircraft cabin while it is on the final approach. Hence, detecting transmissions from within the cabin may prove to be useful in detecting these attacks. Given the simple analog nature of ILS, it is extremely challenging to develop a feasible countermeasure as it is impossible to encrypt physical characteristics of a signal. Over the years, various countermeasures have been proposed for ADS-B. These include cryptographic solutions, which involves message encryption, message authentication codes, and use of public key infrastructure. However, given the widespread use of ADS-B, it is a logistical nightmare to deploy cryptographic solutions as they require overhaul of the entire ADS-B ecosystem. Multilateration uses a network of ground stations which share information. Ghost aircrafts can be easily detected using this technique. ADS-B data can be combined with primary radar for identifying ghost aircrafts as they won't have a radar signature. For preventing ACAS and TCAS spoofing, onboard receivers can deploy distance bounding protocols which can verify the distance between the receiver and the transmitter without relying on position data received from the ADS-B packets. There is widespread use of machine learning and AI for anomaly detection and traffic analysis for detecting spoofed ADS-B packets. Given the simplex broadcast nature or implementation of these systems, it is not trivial to develop countermeasures which can safeguard against a variety of attacks. However, finally, the most important countermeasure is effective pilot training. Pilots should be trained to detect and counter such attacks using instruments at their disposal. Thank you.